Good morning.
It's so delightful to be in worship with all of you gathered here and to be invited into your homes for those of you who are worshiping with us online on this day. Welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to worship. I'd invite you as we begin the service to take those friendship pads. If you are in the sanctuary, that's a chance for you to know the people in your pews if you don't know them. Also for us to be able to keep a good track of who's here and how we can connect with you and vice versa. If you are at home, there you have a chance to sign the online friendship pad. So please do that as well. It helps us stay connected to each other. So coming up this evening, we have a tie-dye party for our youth. So all incoming fifth graders through 12th graders and even our seniors who are on their way to college, if you want to come at 6:30, they're going to tie-dye First Pres Youth Group shirts they can wear to community serving opportunities, other things that they do to represent the church. Maddie's going to host that in the parking lot tonight at 6:30 to 8 o'clock. So we hope that the youth will come to that this evening. On Tuesday, just prior to the church picnic, we'll have a creation care walk at Coast Guard Park. It'll begin at 5 o'clock. This is a great chance for us to connect with our families, to clean up God's earth, and then, of course, to head over and eat some food together at our neighborhood picnic, which will be at North Beach Park. Rumor is that there is a little bit more of a beach this year than there has been in the past. So we have our hospitality committee will provide food for this event. It's always a delightful time to gather together. I think our last two have had over 100 people at them. Clearly, there is a desire within this church family to reconnect in ways that feel on the safe side. So we hope that this will be one of those. If you have not yet signed up for that and are interested in going, there's a sign-up sheet right in the church office, or give us a call. We'd like to know those numbers today, if possible, so that our hospitality committee can have the right amount of food there for you. Coming up on Sunday, August 29th, we're doing what we call Blessing Sunday. So we know the school year is just around the corner. We want to offer God's blessing to students, teachers, administrators, volunteers, basically anyone who has a school connection. We will do that as part of our worship and offer God's blessing on all of those school-related folk. And we will also be welcoming our fifth graders to be a part of the worshiping family of the church because they are no longer a part of the Young Children and Worship program. There will be cupcakes during the coffee hours, too. So if you need anything to sweeten the deal for you, we have done it. We'd be glad to have you be a part of that as we bless all of those who work so hard to educate our children. One final announcement today. I don't often get to do this because it doesn't always fall on a Sunday, but today is Mary Ann Beery's birthday. And we all know how grateful we are for her. I will not make her stand in front of you, but we are going to sing. You ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Mary Ann. Happy birthday to you. We're very grateful for Mary Ann, and it's good to be able to celebrate. And frankly, how often do we get to sing happy birthday with a choir? Friends, it is good to be in worship with you today. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
As is our custom, we light a candle at the beginning of every worship service to remind ourselves, just as the choir sang, that surely the Lord is in this place. Not just this sanctuary, but wherever we go, wherever God calls us to be, wherever we live our daily lives. So we light this candle as a reminder to give thanks to God that God is with us wherever we are, and it is God that unites us, and it is God who we worship and whose unlimited love never fails. If you are able, please rise and join me in the call to worship. Christ calls us to come to worship, to rest from the things that are troubling us, to learn what Christ can teach of life, to realize what we can offer others, and so to return into the world to serve. Let us worship God. Lately, I've been trying to help my kids name what it is that they're feeling, especially when they are having a hard time, because there's something about naming what it is that deeply troubles us, that frees us from whatever that trouble is. In a similar fashion, that's what we do for the prayer, in the prayer of confession. We are naming the burden we carry. We're naming our mistakes. We're naming the fact that we're not perfect. We're naming the fact that we need Jesus Christ. We are naming the fact that we need Christ's forgiveness. We are naming the fact that we need his forgiveness and his love, because it's only Christ's love that can free us from what we need, from what mistakes we need to name. So please join me in the prayer of confession. O God, we long to rest in you, to trust in your goodness, in your care for us, in your abundant life. We don't know how to rest, and we have forgotten how to trust. We seek more material goods than we really need. We grow addicted to productivity. We have trapped ourselves in our own lifestyle. Slow us down, Holy One. Attend to us, Holy One, and show us that you are our salvation and our resting place. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. God is the God of the living. The Holy One will make a place for you that is full of life and love and forgiveness, humility, kindness, and justice. You belong to God who loves you. Rest in that truth. Remember, you are forgiven and we are free. Thanks be to God. Amen.
You're being seated. I'd invite the children to join me down front. Good morning. How are you all doing? Good. So good to see you all. Welcome back. It's good to see you. So I got this in the mail. You have any idea what this is? Do you keep these hung around your house at all? It's a calendar. This is, in fact, the Presbyterian planning calendar. These things are like gold for Presbyterians. They tell us what's going on Sundays, when all the special holy days are. And you can see, like, some of these days already have lots of stuff written on them, right? Now, you're probably not at the age where you're keeping a calendar, are you? Your parents kind of just tell you what you're doing. You got soccer tonight, or, you know, you're going to the church today, those sorts of things. But I'll tell you, these calendars have really small spots. And we adults are really good at maximizing every last little bit of white space on here until we're tired. Your parents ever look tired? Just a little bit? Do you tell them they need a nap? No. Do you take naps anymore? No. There comes a day when you're going to want to start taking naps again. I brought a pillow with me. I'm not going to take a nap during church. But I tell you what, on Sunday afternoons, it feels like a really good time to put my head down and close my eyes and catch a little bit of rest. We've been talking all summer about this word called Sabbath, and it means all sorts of things, but one of the major things it means is that God created us to work really hard for 6 days, and we do that, and to play really hard for 6 days. But on a seventh day, God created us for rest, and it's important to rest. So you should encourage your parents to take a nap. It's okay. It could be on a Sunday afternoon. You can help them out that way, but you guys, it's important for you to rest too. I think sometimes we expect that you do too much too. So it's okay to do a little bit less and to say that I need to rest too. That's part of what God made me for. So that's what we've been learning about this whole summer. I think I'll probably plan to rest a little bit this afternoon, and I hope you find space to do that, especially once your school year starts back up and you're a lot busier with school and all your other good activities that you do. So I appreciate you guys spending time with me this morning. Would you fold your hands? And let's bow our heads and pray together. Dear God, we thank you for creating us to work hard for 6 days and to rest for one. Help us to find balance in the ways that we live. In Jesus' name, amen. You may go back with your families. Good to see you all.
And please join me in prayer. God in heaven, we are grateful for your word that is not static, but is dynamic and speaks to us no matter where we are in life. Even if it's a familiar passage, you speak something new to us, something that we need to learn about you and your love for us and for others. So we pray, Lord, that you would open our ears, our minds, our hearts, our entire selves to your word this morning. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Our Old Testament lesson this morning comes from Ezekiel chapter 20, verses 19 through 20. If you'd like to follow along, it can be found on page 687 in the Old Testament part of your pew Bible. Hear God's word for you, for me, for all of us. I, the Lord, am your God. Follow my statutes and be careful to observe my ordinances and hallow my Sabbaths that they may be a sign between me and you so that you may know that I, the Lord, am your God. Word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We've been focused on this theme of Sabbath. This is our 10th and final week. We've been calling it Living 24/6, and today is the culmination of that. We turn to Luke chapter 4, verses 14 through 21 for our gospel reading, and this is really the announcement of Jesus to begin his public ministry in this particular gospel of Luke. So let's continue to listen to God's word together. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. On New Year's Eve, 1999, Jess and I were spending time at my parents' home with a couple of college friends. We were barely a few weeks into our relationship, and already we were facing our first worldwide crisis, the Y2K bug. Now, if you are older than 20 and listening to this, you probably recall this scare. Younger than that, you probably are wondering what in the world I'm talking about. Over decades of writing computer code with the year field in the code of being only two digits, that is, 1988 was 88 in the code, for example, there was a possible major issue in the offing as we entered the new millennium in 2000, because the computers might think it was 1900, 00. And that had possible disastrous consequences. People feared that the air traffic control systems would fail, or all our financial data might crash and get lost. There were lots of fears. Governments and companies spent billions to get their systems prepared for this. Fearing the worst, people, like they do, stocked up on food and supplies, sort of like they did on toilet paper at the beginning of the pandemic. Part of the reason we were at my parents' was because my parents had stocked up. To this day, we laugh about some of the choices they made for what they stocked up on, one of which included gigantic jars of Sam's Club mayonnaise. If the world is falling apart, we have to make sure we have plenty of condiments, don't we? That New Year's Eve, we didn't take Prince's advice and party like it was 1999. We sat in my parents' living room, staring at the screen of a very old laptop. We were waiting for the computer to turn to midnight. And part of me was hoping the computer would just start smoking and shaking violently until it just blew up and disappeared. This is why I'm not an engineer, right? Or maybe the screen would just go wonky. But the clock turned, and nothing happened. It was a new year. Our old computer survived. We wished each other a happy new year and went to sleep, comforted that there was still plenty of mayonnaise in the Y2K stash. Now, the Y2K bug held off a bit because of all the investment and software patches. But that doesn't mean that nothing happened. In Australia, bus ticket validation stopped working. In Japan, an alarm sounded 2 minutes after midnight at a nuclear power plant. In the U.S. Naval Observatory, which keeps the official time for the country, we had a clock error. The official date the Naval Observatory gave on its website was January 1st, 19,100. And also, 150 lottery machines in Delaware just stopped working. It's tragic. Now, not everyone's attention was fixated on the Y2K scare. The change from 1999 to 2000 led people around the world to ask themselves, how can we make this new millennium better than the last one? A movement called Jubilee 2000, led by the singer Bono and supported by many celebrities and governments, advocated for the canceling of debts that poor countries owed to wealthy countries. It was based on the year of Jubilee, a concept found in the Bible in Leviticus 25, where every 50 years the Bible counsels that debts are to be canceled. The playing field should be leveled. The Jubilee 2000 effort led to tens of billions of debt being written off, giving these poorer nations a better chance of finding themselves on more solid economic footing. What fascinates me today about this is that practical engagement with debts and the economy was rooted in the biblical idea of Sabbath. As we've dived into this throughout the summer, there is this sense that practicing Sabbath is a faith claim, that we don't have to do it all, and that there is, in fact, space for grace in life. We've focused on Sabbath as a way of living 24/6, that is, going all in on life for 6 days a week and leaving one day to just be. But let's be honest here. I suspect very few of us shut things down for 24 hours once a week. I must admit that throughout this series, I have struggled mightily to practice Sabbath, and that failure has been to my own detriment as I feel more and more ground down. So we've been aiming a lot smaller than 24 hours at a shot. We've been saying, how about a couple hours here or there? Just find a little bit of Sabbath time, which is a great starting point. But Sabbath is a concept that builds upon itself. Biblically speaking, it is integral to living fully. One day a week, every week, there is Sabbath. And yet, in the Bible, there are Sabbath years too. Did you know that? It's where we get the concept of an academic or a pastoral sabbatical. Just as once a week, every week, we are to stop, so every seventh year, according to the Bible, is to be a Sabbath year. Could you imagine our world if we did that? In the agricultural world of the Bible, it was a year to let your fields go fallow. And just like the Lord provided for the Israelites as they wandered in the desert with a double portion on the day before the Sabbath, so they had enough, so the Lord would provide for their needs in the Sabbath year. But wait, there's more. Because after seven cycles of Sabbath years, that is after 49 years, there is a Sabbath year of all Sabbath years, the year of Jubilee. And that's when the debts were to be canceled and the lands were to be restored. It was a grand restoring of human society aligned with God's design for the world. And that's where the roots of the Jubilee 2000 campaign came from. The Jubilee was a chance to celebrate God's provision, God's goodwill, trusting that in this grand resetting, God would continue to provide for the needs of all. The year of Jubilee, once every 50 years, is the grand culmination of the Sabbath. And so you may be thinking, Troy, this is all very interesting, but no one does this, do they? Might help me on trivia night, but it's not practical. No one lives this way. So let me tell you about Jesus then. Our text in Luke 4 acts as an introduction to Jesus' ministry. He is back in Nazareth, the town where he grew up. These people know Jesus. They know his family. It's the Sabbath day, and as part of their practice, they go to the synagogue. The practice of Christian worship today still has its roots in what the Sabbath looked like on the synagogue. There would be prayers, collection of money for the poor, the reading of Scripture, commentary on Scripture. And on this occasion, Jesus reads the Scripture and comments on it. And his words come to us from late in the prophet Isaiah's writings. Listen once again to what Jesus reads to them, claiming it as his own. He says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And all who were gathered there stared at Jesus as he rolled the scrolls back up, waiting to hear what he would say about that text. And he finally speaks. "Today," he says, "today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Today. Not someday, not a few years from now, not after we die. Today. Jesus is saying that the year of Jubilee, the culmination of all of those Sabbaths, is at hand. Jesus himself becomes the fulfillment of the Sabbath. All that trust they had on the Lord on those days were still embodied in Jesus. It is quite an amazing statement. You see, Sabbath is a practice, but it is ultimately not about the practice. It is about trust. Do we trust in God's provision? Do we trust Jesus is who he says he is? In Luke 4, Jesus is saying that he is the very embodiment of God's goodwill for the world. He is the one sent to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, to bring sight to the blind, and to set the oppressed free. In other words, he's taking all these things that are a result of our own brokenness and selfishness and resetting them to a place of wholeness. Which leaves us staring down at these two critical questions. Do we believe Jesus is who he says he is? And if we do, will we live in his way? We have been at this topic of Sabbath for 10 weeks. We have touched on a lot of aspects of what Sabbath is, what it means to, in practice, what impact it could have on our lives and the whole world. We've touched on our need for rest. We've talked about how Sabbath creates space for delighting in God, delighting in nature, delighting in each other. We've hit on the fun topics of playfulness and celebration. We've heard how Sabbath gives us space for hospitality and healing. There is a lot to this Sabbath thing. The more I've read and written about the Sabbath this summer, the deeper my appreciation for God's good design has become, and the more I've realized how much I still have to learn about it. I know I'll be wrestling with what this topic means practically for me for a long time, in part because I have this strong leaning towards wanting to live at a fast pace. And I hear God saying, that's not good. It'd be like operating a sports car at full throttle without ever giving it a chance to cool down. And yet I hear God through the writing of Abraham Joshua Heschel, who reminds us that Sabbath is the counterpoint of living. It is the melody sustained through all the stresses which menace our conscience. It is our awareness of God's presence in the world. What we are depends on what Sabbath is to us. What we are depends on what Sabbath is to us. And I hope, like me, you are learning to be more of a human being rather than a human doing, because that's God's intention, but it is a hard lesson. But there is good news in this. Dr. Matthew Sleeth says, in adopting a 24/6 life, we put God back into the equation. We leave some of the figuring out to God. We recharge our batteries with the energy that comes only through stopping. And we become more generous with the gifts God has given to us. Sabbath was meant to restore and renew our souls, but Sabbath keeping is nothing less than grabbing on to the robe of the maker of the universe. As you approach the Sabbath, a measure of awe is in order. The Sabbath is not a part of trendy self-help program. It is a part of heaven and a glimpse of God. Sabbath is not one day of vacation a week. It is part of the most solid, intangible time of life. The Sabbath balances the active parts of life with the holy parts. Jesus needed both to be fully human. And so do we. And so as we close this series on living 24/6, I hope you have a renewed understanding of God's purposes for Sabbath. I hope you learn to be kind to yourselves by stopping and resting in God's provision. I hope you find that worship, whether here or in your homes, is a vital part of being fully human and a part of what helps you live those other 6 days of the week. I hope you're learning to trust that what God wants for you is good for you. May you find yourself at home in the Sabbath, the cathedral that God has built in time. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, you are a God of hospitality. There is none like you that invites all to come to you. You've invited it all to you, your home, to your table, to your arms. Help us to hear and receive this good news. Help us to remember that no one is better than anyone else in your kingdom. And help us then to treat each other the way you treat us all. As we close this sermon series on the Sabbath, help us to remember, Lord, about what we've learned, what we've needed to be reminded of. We thank you that the Sabbath reminds us that we don't and we can't do it all. That the Sabbath is an opportunity for us to make space for grace, to make space to remember who you are, thereby making space to remember who we are, who you've called us to be, that we belong to you. Help us to continue to trust in who you say you are. You are freedom to the captive, sight to the blind, comfort to the suffering, hope in the midst of disappointment. You are the solution to the brokenness that exists in each one of us. You are the solution to the brokenness we've created around us. So help us, Lord, to continue to make room in our lives, room for the Sabbath. For this command you put on our lives is for us. That what you want for us always is good. So help us to trust in that truth. Help us to continue to rest in you. Help us to continue to learn about you. To learn about who you are. For there's always room for us to grow in our faith and in our trust in you. Gracious God, we lift up this world that you love, this world that you created out of love. We lift up those who are suffering in our own neighborhoods, our communities, and around the world. We lift up those who've been affected by the earthquake in Haiti this week. Be near to those who are suffering and in need of your comfort and care. We pray for your peace in Afghanistan, where political upheaval continues to rise. May your peace and justice prevail. Closer to home, and because you treat us with your tender love, we take time to pray for friends and family members, others who need it more than ever. We ask, Lord, that you would pour out your healing and your comfort and care to Alice, Brian and Joan, Earl, Larry, Norm, and Sandy. And we lift up those, Lord, who continue to suffer loss of health, loss of loved ones, to this pandemic that continues to rage its ugly head. We lift up our sister Ann McLaughlin and the loss of her dad to COVID. We pray for Kim Beber and her family and the loss of her aunt in Florida, again to COVID. As the world opens up, help us to be mindful that there are still those who are grieving. There are still those who are afraid. And help us to do our part to listen, to love well, to do our part to keep those most vulnerable in our midst safe. Help us to see others the way you see them, Lord. And we thank you for the hope of your resurrection that reminds us that this life is not always what you wanted it to be for us, and that one day we'll be reunited with you and those we have lost. We are thankful, Lord, that you remain the same yesterday, today, and forever. No matter what our lives look like, no matter what the world looks like. So help us to cling to that fact. And again, we thank you for the gift of the Sabbath, which is an intentional way of making space to remember and trust in your unfailing love for us. There are many prayers in this sanctuary, Lord, that we have yet to put to words, but you know what burdens we carry. You know what lays heavy on our hearts. You know our joys and our sorrow. You know us better than we know ourselves. So for now, we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Everything we do in worship is in response to God's love for us. That includes not just the hymns, not just the sermon, not just the prayers, but also what we give. For what we give, we are saying that we are partnering with God and what he's already doing in our midst. I know it's been said time and time again, but thank you for your generosity, for what you're able to give of your time and of your finances continues to fuel what God is doing through each one of us, not just in this church building, but throughout the community and the world.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you that every good and perfect gift comes from you. And we are grateful for the gifts that have been put in this offering plate that have been given in other means. And we ask, Lord, that it would bring glory to the greatest gift of all, the gift of yourself and Jesus Christ, in whom we live and have our being, in whom we are held together. And we ask, Lord, that what has been given would be used to spread the good news of Jesus Christ within this church, in our neighborhoods, our community, and throughout the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
So, my friends, as we faithfully live our lives in this coming week, what are we called to do? We are called to celebrate God's grace as a Christ-centered community of acceptance, growing in faith and living as Christ's hands to serve. And so, my friends, as you leave this place this day, I pray that this would be just a part of your Sabbath practice, for worship is surely an important part of what it means to be God's people, but that you may also find those spaces for grace and even a little bit of the discipline to be the kind of people God created you to be in the first place, and to trust that you will have a fuller, more abundant life by doing less, by having a little less. That is part of what all of this means. May you know what Sabbath is in your own life. And brothers and sisters, live simply, love generously, serve faithfully, speak truthfully, pray daily, and leave everything else up to God as you go from this place to be God's Sabbath people. Amen.